Hi, folks. Welcome to the Cannabis Corner. I'm your host, Kerry Burns. In 1956, we saw the last legal production of hemp in this country. This was part of the Hemp for Victory campaign that started in 1942. The government actually made its last purchase of hemp in 1948, but there were still some production going on up into about the mid-50s, and then it ceased altogether. Surprisingly enough, though, the use of cannabis did not slow down. In fact, from the period of 1956 to 1967, cannabis use in the United States saw a thousand-fold increase. Now, this is a pretty substantial number when you look at the fact that 1,000 times more people were smoking cannabis than there were at the height of the end of the Hemp for Victory campaign. The Federal Bureau of Narcotics even saw this increase, and from 1956 to 1967, they actually added 50 more agents to their supply, and they went from about 220 in 1956 agents nationwide to a total of 279. And if you look at Anslinger and his comments, he always said that, well, you know, the user out there doesn't have to worry about it because most of these arrests that we're making, 75 to 80% of them are dealers. And the other 20 to 25%, these are actual dealers that pleaded down to possession charges. So they were pretty much trying to make the claim that none of the users were being arrested. And this was just absolutely erroneous. In California in 1960, the primary narcotics arrests were for heroin use, and they weren't for distribution. These were just individual people that were caught, you know, shooting up heroin on the streets and stuff. And most of these were Mexican immigrants that had come into the country, and they were just in that part of society. It was sort of the low end of society, and they, you know, got addicted to heroin, probably brought the habit from Mexico. And this made up the bulk of the arrest going on then. And then gradually, you started seeing this increase in marijuana arrests. And it got to the point where the main arrests being made were marijuana, and very few being arrested for the harder narcotics like heroin. In 1968, the Federal Bureau of Narcotics, they had a meeting trying to decide how dangerous cannabis and marijuana was. And they had representatives from the United States, they had them from the Netherlands, they had them from Canada, then from, you know, many, many of the countries around the world that we do business with, England, all those. And pretty much the general consensus was that cannabis was not a threat to society, that it wasn't dangerous. Yet, you know, nobody talked about, you know, ending the laws on it. People were still going to jail for it. And in 1970, the ability to enforce the cannabis laws really kind of fell off the map. Law enforcement themselves were telling people, look, we can't stop the users. There are so many people using cannabis that to try to enforce this is just, it's an unattainable end. We will not be able to stop this. Nixon had his Operation Intercept, and this was kind of like what's going on today, strange enough, but this Operation Intercept, which they did in 1970, was to try to seal off the Mexican border because back then, most of the marijuana coming in the United States was from Mexico. The homegrown market in California was just in its infant stages then, and so the primary producer of the marijuana being smoked in the United States was coming from Mexico. So Nixon got this harebrained idea that he was just going to shut the border down. Well, that failed miserably, even more so than today. I mean, they just weren't able to stop it, and as a consequence, they were unable to stop the flow of the marijuana, too. In 69, all of these countries met together. They pretty much said that all of the dangers of marijuana and everything that had been published about it was highly exaggerated, and this was just pretty much a political ploy to keep the laws illegal. And everything was, you know, in 1966, we had Timothy Leary filed suit against the United States government over the Marijuana Tax Act. And basically what he was saying was that the act said that you had to show up with the product in hand to get the tax stamp to make sure that you weren't arrested. But guess what? When you showed up with the cannabis in hand, you were already arrested. So you pretty much incriminated yourself. And so the Supreme Court threw this law out. The 1937 Marijuana Tax Act was thrown out by the Supreme Court of the United States in 1966. And so really from a period of about 1966 to 1972, there were no laws on the books concerning marijuana. But the arrests didn't stop. In fact, they just kept getting more numerous and more numerous and more numerous. And at the last minute, the cannabis was going to be left off of the Controlled Substance Act. First of all, they were having a hard time with the scheduling of it. One, it wasn't a narcotic. It wasn't addictive. The plants were, there was two separate plants with cannabis. You had the male plants, which pretty much all they were for was to produce the pollen. And then the female plants that produced the flowers that people like to smoke. So it was tough for them to even legislate it. Because here you have one plant that's pretty much not psychoactive and pretty much a pollen source. And then on the other side, you've got the female plant, and it's the one that produces the flowers that everybody wants to smoke. So that it made it very difficult for them to come up with any type of legislation to make it enforceable. But strangely enough, how our government works at the last minute, kind of like pork barrel fashion, they managed to slide cannabis into the Controlled Substance Act. This probably would have been okay if they'd have kept it down at the bottom around Schedule 4, which is the lowest form of the drugs that they have on the Controlled Substance Act. But what do? They put it Schedule 1, equated with heroin, methamphetamine, even cocaine was Schedule 2. That kind of gives you an idea of what they were, where they were with this. So they put it up there in the Schedule 1 category. It's the worst one, the one that carried the highest penalty. And the laws at the time, and they are still holding up today, but if you were caught with more than 1,000 pounds of marijuana or 1,000 plants, you did a mandatory 40-year to life sentence, and there was no chance of parole, none. If you were caught with 100 pounds or 100 plants or more, you did an automatic 10-year sentence. This could be as high as 40 years, and there was no chance of parole. It wasn't until you got down below 50 pounds and 50 plants that you served a time between 5 and 10 years. Mandatory state jail time was at least 5 years, and there was a slim chance of parole. Now, when you look at murders out there and all, there's a lot of murderers that get away with, you know, 15 to 25 years, and they have a chance of parole. But yet here you have a substance that's an herb that people were being arrested for, and depending on the quantity, you could do up to a life sentence with absolutely no chance of getting paroled out. And this was the absurdity of the whole thing at the time. But they managed to get cannabis slipped into the Controlled Substance Act. And not only did they slip it in, they put it in high fashion at Schedule 1, right there at the top with the most dangerous of everything out there. Even though alcohol and cigarettes, which are the most dangerous drugs out there and they kill more people, these weren't even on the Controlled Substance Act. They learned their lesson long ago about prohibition and with the alcohol. And so certainly they weren't going to try to run that gambit again. But sadly enough, cannabis did make that list, and it didn't, you know, in 72, before the Controlled Substance Act was passed, the National Commission on Marijuana, they said that marijuana posed no potential harm to society, and its use did not justify, if you will, the type of social laws that they were trying to put in place to enforce it. They said it was absolutely harmless to the point that we can't go after and punish these people for using it when there's not really proof that it's a danger to society. And even with all of that, and that was a federal commission that came up with that. This wasn't some private affair. This was one the government sanctioned, and their bottom line statement was that marijuana wasn't dangerous enough to have all of these laws that they were proposing to be against it. But none of that mattered. Same way when the 1937 Tax Act passed, no matter who came in there and told them, look, this is wrong and all that, nobody listened to them. Controlled Substance Act, same way. Look, we're going to put this on there. It's dangerous, and we're going to enforce it. And that's what happened. And it got put in there. And, of course, the statement by Anslinger in 68 saying that most of the arrests were for dealers, and even the possession charges that were done by these people that pleaded their plea down. But that's not true. And since the 60s, 70s, 80s, 90s, 2000, on up, every year, when you look at the total arrests for drugs in this country, 80 to 90% of them were for marijuana, and 90% of those were for possession. Very few of them were for distribution. And that pretty much was the trend, and is still the trend today. Up to 2 million people a year being arrested for cannabis, and 80 to 85% of them are being arrested for possession and not distribution.